On Saturday, January 4th at 7:16 a.m., patrol officers were dispatched to the Arco gas station at 2375 Quimby Road after a gas station employee called 911 to report a man was standing at the pumps holding a lighter. The first officer to arrive at the gas station was Officer Santana, who could see the suspect standing in the area of the gas pumps. The suspect had removed one of the pump nozzles and was holding it in one hand. And in the other hand, he had a small lighter that he was using to try to light a wad of paper that he had placed into the pump nozzle. The officer immediately began speaking to the suspect and attempting to get him to step away from the gas pumps. The suspect did not comply and continued attempting to light the paper with the lighter. Prior to the first officers arriving, a customer was pumping gas and observed the suspect trying to light the pump on fire and then moved away from the suspect. The suspect was also holding a long metal pipe and not responding to Officer Santana's repeated commands for the suspect to put down the pump and the lighter. The second officer to arrive was Officer Cesarez, who ran and attempted to disable the gas pumps while Officer Santana continued to try and persuade the suspect to move away from the pumps. Both officers retrieved less lethal stun bag shotguns from their vehicles. They continued giving commands to try to get the suspect to drop the lighter, but the suspect continued trying to light the paper. The suspect then dropped the pump, raised the metal rod over his head, and charged at Officer Cesarez. Officer Cesarez shot one round from his stun bag shotgun, striking the suspect, but having no effect. Officer Cesarez continued to retreat away as the suspect ran directly at him. Officer Santana also fired two stun bag rounds at the suspect, which also did not have any effect. The altercation continued around the police vehicle, into the street, and back to the gas station as the suspect continued swinging the metal pipe. Officer Santana transitioned to his taser and fired at the suspect, but the taser deployment was also ineffective. While in his retreat, Officer Santana fell to the ground on River Rocks as the suspect continued charging Officer Cesarez with the pipe in hand. Officer Cesarez fired one shot from his pistol, striking the suspect. However, that shot did not appear to be effective as the suspect kept coming. Officer Santana also fired a shot at the suspect, striking but not stopping him as he continued charging at Officer Cesarez with the pipe. Officer Cesarez then fired an additional round, which caused the suspect to fall to the ground. This ended the assault on our police officers, and he was taken into custody. The officers immediately called for medical attention. The suspect was transported to the area hospital where he was treated, is in stable condition, and is expected to survive his injuries. Officer Santana sustained a minor injury to his knee as a result of the incident. He has 8 months of experience as a police officer, is CIT trained, activated his body-worn camera before contacting the suspect, and was placed on routine paid administrative leave. Officer Cesarez was not injured. He has just over 1 year of experience as a police officer, is CIT trained, activated his body-worn camera as well before contacting the suspect, and was placed on routine administrative leave. The Santa Clara County District Attorney's Office and the San Jose Police Department's Homicide Unit are conducting the joint criminal investigation. The case is being monitored by the San Jose Police Department's Internal Affairs Unit, the City Attorney's Office, and the Office of the Independent Police Auditor. The suspect is Jose Antonio De Los Santos, a 32-year-old San Jose resident on parole for assault with a deadly weapon and a gang registrant with the San Jose PD. After being released from the hospital, he will be booked for assault on a police officer with a deadly weapon and attempted arson. We do not have a toxicology report at this time, and we're not aware of any mental health issues. He does not have any prior mental health holds. His criminal convictions include auto theft, carrying a concealed dirk or dagger, fighting in public, resisting arrest, hit and run with injury, and 2 counts of assault with a deadly weapon, where he served 4 years and 2 months of a 9-year sentence before being paroled. Luckily, there was no loss of life in this incident. It was ominous to begin with, and it escalated quickly. The officers on scene acted bravely, were resourceful, tactically retreated, used de-escalation techniques. However, in the end, this individual dictated the outcome. And with that, I'll open it up to questions.
What sparked it to try to light the gas pump on fire?
You know, right now, just so you know, I mean, we don't have any talks yet to see if he was under the influence of anything. Obviously, very erratic behavior, but we don't know exactly what was causing him to light that pump on fire.
Did he say anything at all during the encounter or anything?
You know, honestly, we're going to be releasing body cam footage on this in a few weeks. And I will tell you, one of the things that we all noticed was towards his charge at the officers, was a very ominous laugh that the suspect had. There was something going on, whether it was a mental health episode, stimulant influence of some sort, but it was very, very odd behavior.
Can you give us the full names of the officers?
We'll get you the full names after.
Did you say that when you tased him, did they actually get tased, or was that an attempted?
Well, the officer utilized his taser. The officer doesn't know if both prongs hit the individual, but he definitely tried to utilize and did discharge his taser at the suspect. But it had little to no effect.
So they used non-lethal beanbag from their cars, as you said, and tasers, and then they used their weapons, correct?
Well, honestly, Jesse, if you go back, I mean, this individual is being spoken to by the officer for about 4 minutes prior to all this happening, which we have on body worn camera. So trying to talk the suspect down to have him surrender, they used a tactical retreat. Then I would get into the less lethal tools that they have with the stun bag shotgun, the taser. And then finally, they use their firearm. So, I mean, you know, we think of de-escalation techniques as the tools, but these officers, I mean, used other tools that, you know, police officers have been using for years, trying to talk the suspect down, trying to bring the individual into custody safely, used tactical retreat. Very proud of their actions.
Talk to me about that, because one is only 8 months on the job and the other a year, is that correct?
Yes.
That's not a whole lot of experience. It seems like they followed it by the book, et cetera, and took the training that you guys have implemented to use.
Well, I tell you, to be honest with you, you know, and obviously the investigation is ongoing. I'm telling you from my own personal experience what I think. But, you know, whether you're on a year or whether you're on 28 years, you know, approaching an individual at a gas pump who's trying to light the gas pump on fire, I don't know if any amount of training is ever going to prepare you to really how to deal with that. What I'm pleased is the fact that they truly tried to de-escalate the situation, and that in the end is one of the things that we all know that we're judged by. So I'm very proud of their actions.
Is it accurate to say they went above and beyond what they needed to do before pulling out?
You know what? No, I'm not going to say they did above and beyond what they needed to do. They did what they felt was necessary in that instant.
What I mean is that they could have been justified in taking that action earlier.
You know, I don't know. Only the officers have to be justified. They have to feel in their own mind that they're justified. They felt that what they do, they needed to do. And in the end, again, luckily, there was no loss of life. But this individual dictated this outcome.
So when you describe that ominous laugh, what do you really mean? Like,
wow.
More about the guy.
I'm not going to sit here and like act out the laugh that he did. But it's just, I mean, it's not, and you'll see it and you'll hear it actually when the body cam footage is released, but it's not normal behavior to be running at police officers with a weapon, much less running at police officers who are armed with a weapon and then laughing. I think any kind of laugh in that situation is somewhat ominous. And so it was. There's certainly something was going on inside this individual that we really may never know.
San Jose resident, or
he was a San Jose resident.
Families here too.
That I don't know.
I mean, did you contact anybody with his family? Could say
you know, he's been going through X or he's had problems with X?
I don't know if we've gotten to that point just yet.
Do your officers receive a specific kind of training for situations like this where there might be a mental health issue or where there might be some kind of drugs involved where somebody's clearly behaving in a way that you just said was not normal?
Yes, they do. Again, both officers were CIT trained. But again, you know, and we say this, and I've said this many times, CIT is not a panacea. CIT works when people want to listen. When an individual is trying to light a gas pump on fire and then charges at officers with a weapon, I don't know what amount of CIT at that point between that distance is necessarily going to help in that situation. But it's an important tool that our officers do have when individuals do want to listen. It's important as well. But again, the tactical retreat, the de-escalation, you know, the utilizing our less lethal options, you know, they're all things that, you know, we want our officers doing. You know, and I think officers did a very admirable job in this case. And, you know, when you think about averted what could have been a major, major catastrophe in that neighborhood.
So would you say that considering the time they took to finally use a firearm, there's some sort of, like, improvement of the tactics and the escalation techniques that the police department is using compared to other instances?
Well, no, I don't think that's a fair account. What I'll say is that the officers did at that time what they thought was necessary and utilized the tools that they have. Every situation is different, and I'm not going to tell you that in every situation where we end up shooting an individual that the officers are going to go through de-escalation, tactical retreat, less lethal stun bags, taser. That may not happen on every time. In this particular case, the officers utilized those tools, and it worked in their favor. Every situation is different, and you cannot judge this situation. You cannot judge other situations by what happened in this situation.
Can you describe the weapon? You mentioned a metal rod or a metal bar. What exactly is?
It looked like a long pipe that you would put into like an industrial type of car jack. Is what it appeared to be.
Like a tire iron kind of thing?
It was longer, a little longer and thicker than that as well. And again, you know what, Robert, we didn't have a picture of it, but since we would put now body-worn camera footage on this in a few weeks, so, I mean, it'll speak for itself.
How close did you come to actually igniting the paper? And we were talking to the gas station people. Would it have been, had he been able to do what he did, would he have been able to actually set the gas pump on fire?
You know, Robert, I tell you, I don't... I don't know if we're in a position at this point to really ascertain that. I think in the end, you know, as I mentioned earlier, you know, the same question you asked with regards to if, you know, I don't know what amount of training could prepare you for something like this particular case. I think even, you know, we don't get any additional training on, you know, on lighting gas pumps. So I think we always assume the worst, right? An individual with a lighter and, you know, and sticking a piece of paper into a pump and trying to light it on fire is all bad. I don't know.
And he kept on trying to light it even while the officers were talking to him, right?
Yes, that's what that's how the case is looking.
And just to clarify earlier when I was saying going above and beyond, what I meant was it seemed like the officers took even more steps than they, you know, would have even been required to stop somebody from doing something like that. They took those extra steps.
I think they utilized the tools and the training that they've been given, and they thought in that particular situation the tools that they've been taught, and they used them. I mean, I don't want to say that they could have shot him sooner or what have you, we weren't there, I wasn't there. You know, we have body worn camera and everything else. At the end of the day, it's those officers who felt that threatened. It's those officers whose lives were in danger. And they felt that they were going to utilize the tools that they've been given and have this outcome. Anything else?
Earlier reports stated that the suspect had driven off and then returned. Is that accurate or no?
I don't know. I don't know if I really haven't gotten that officially yet. I think I did hear some mentioning about that earlier, but in the briefings that I've been given, I haven't heard that.
Okay. And then one more time, could you share what he'll be booked on once he's released from the hospital?
Assault a deadly weapon on a police officer and attempted arson.
Okay.
One count of assault of a police officer or two?
I believe, how many counts? Two.
Two counts of assault of a police officer.
So in summary, the suspect was hit three times?
Yes.
Okay. Did the suspect have any other weapons on him once he was apprehended?
Once he was apprehended, no, I don't believe so. The lighter that he used? I was told it was a lighter. I don't know how many different types. I think just a regular little lighter.
Big is it though?
You know what? One of them. Let's put this, something that could have lit a piece of paper on fire is what he used. Anything else?
Just real quick, go over his history again.
Auto theft, carrying a concealed dirk or dagger, fighting in public, resisting arrest, hit and run with injury, two counts of assault with a deadly weapon. Those are the highlights.
Those are all arrests or convictions? I know you had the 4 years in prison for the...
Yeah, I believe those are convictions.
How long have you been
I don't know exactly. We just know. I think he had that 9-month sentence for the assault with a deadly weapon, where he had stabbed someone, and I think he served a little over 4 years, four and a half years, on that sentence before he was paroled. But other than that, I don't know the last time.
That was recently.
Yeah, I don't know when that is. When that was.
So 9 months, 9 years.
9 years. You have 9-year sentence.
Okay, 9 years.
Yeah, a 9-year sentence on that on that assault with a deadly weapon.
So he served four out of the 9.
Yeah, I think he served 4.5. No, he served 4 years and 2 months of a 9-year sentence before being paroled.
I used parole.
I'm sorry?
He was paroled.
He's currently on parole. Yes.
So can you do
We'll do it after. Okay, good. Thank you, everyone.